We're going to speak today about men and women according to Judaism. It's a very, very known opinion in the secular world that the woman is a second degree citizen according to the Torah. And that's a very, very big mistake. Not only that it's not true, in many aspects of the life of the woman, she is considered higher than the man in the eyes of God. I give one example before we start. The most important thing in a Jewish family, it's the house. A woman in Judaism, according to the Torah, she is called, she has a nickname. Besides calling her Isha, how the Gemara call a woman? Beito, the house of a man. The house of the man. Why they call the woman the house? Why they call her the house? Because everything in a house is determined on her quality. She's a kosher woman, most likely your house will be kosher. If she's not a kosher woman, who knows what can happen in this house? She is the foundation of the house. So the Torah say, Beto means his wife. And the most important thing in a Jewish family is the future, the raising the children, making sure your children will follow the path of God and the truth that he gave us in Mount Sinai 3,322 years ago. Where do we see that it's the most important thing? Just before Abraham died, what does Hashem say about him? I love Abraham. Do you know what it is? Do you know what it means from billions and billions of people that ever lived in this world? The book of God, he took your name and he put you in big places in the Torah, whole stories about your life, who are you, who is your wife, your son, what you did, your conversation with God. He became an integral part of the book of God. I'm not talking here, this is something very important. But there's one thing to be mentioned in the book of God, which is a great thing, but there is an extra level now when God writes with his own signature in his book, Ahavti et Avraham, I love Abraham. And he said the two reasons why he loved him. Because he will teach his children the Torah that I taught him. That's why I love him. Understand? So a father that doesn't do it to his children, right away lose his kindness in the eyes of God. Ahavti et Avraham. Why? Because he will teach the children my Torah. And because he himself kept all my Torah. Ekev asher shamar et torotai, mitzvotai v'chukotai. Two reasons. One, he was preaching right to his children. Second, wasn't only giving them speeches and leave the opposite like some parents do. Was still telling them what to do and set a perfect example. So, Avraham Avinu, Hashem loved him because he passed the Torah to the future generations. In the Jewish family, who is in charge of raising the children? Who is all the time with them? Who is in charge of raising them, feeding them, teaching them how to make brachot, talking to them about modesty, giving them an example how you read Tehillim, how you pray? Who is with them all the time? The mother. Since they are babies, right away they are attached to the mother. Who has a more important job in a Jewish family, the father or the mother? Such big responsibility Hashem put in the hands of the women. It's not a coincidence. What is it like? Imagine the Israeli army. What's more important in the Israeli army? A pilot of F-16 who fly and bomb the atomic nuclear facility in Iraq and soon in Iran, Bezrat Hashem, or a little person that writes orders for the milk, for the bread to the kitchen, to make sure, you know, there's enough cucumbers and that they clean the kitchen and the bathroom is clean and has toilet paper. It's also important. You need cucumbers, you need toilet paper. But someone who compared this guy to this pilot that could be life of millions depend on his hand, to compare this to this, you have to be a total ignorant. Everybody understand this one is more important in the operation. If God put the future of the family, the future of the Jewish nation, Bet Yaakov, the women, in their hands, that means not only they're not second-class citizens, they are actually coming even before the men. So let's give some examples of the status of the Jewish woman according to the Torah. First, we all know that there is a difference, major difference, in the physical way we are created. Man is created in one physical way. A woman is created in a different physical way. This is something that everybody understands, even without the Torah. But there's also other differences. The mentality of a man and the mentality of the woman, no matter if they grow up together in the same life, same family, same neighborhood, same school, everything the same, will never ever be the same. You take a woman and try to force her to be like a man in her behaving, in her traits. And you take a man and try to force him to be like a woman, it will never work. In Egypt, somebody who understood that very well was Paro. Paro invented a way to destroy the Jews mentally, not physically. What does it mean, avodat parech? What does it mean, parech? Parech comes from the word pircha, lifroch, lafrich. When you have a kushia, when you have a question, somebody say, make a statement, and you come with a strong question, and you smash the proof. The proof is not valid. So that's called in Hebrew, mafrich, mafrich et ha'ochacha. Ifrachta, you made it, you turned it around. That's what it means, parech. Parech means the opposite of what they are created for. The man is created for physical work, is able to do it. So Paro made him sew and do women's job. And the women who was created for soft jobs, using their mind, all kinds of things, he made them work in very hard physical work to torture them mentally. When a person do what he's able to do, it doesn't destroy him mentally. Maybe physically, yes, you're very tired. Your back hurts, your legs hurts, your head, everything fine. But mentally, you're not destroyed. But when you are doing a job that is against your nature, it destroys you mentally. This is how they destroyed the Jews mentally. That was their mind. Avodat parech. Now, there is a very serious difference in a nefesh, in a spirit of a man as opposed to a woman. Completely different. It's like trying to compare red and white, two different colors, nothing in mutual. The women connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu very easy. Many times you come to a lecture, you give a story, which I'm going to give you some good stories later today. Right away you see the women clean tears from their eyes. 2 minutes later, they already talk about keeping Shabbos. What happened? You came to the lecture completely not religious, now you're ready to go? No proofs, no arguments, true, not true, different than the men. You talk to the heart of the woman, you ignite her nefesh to wake up. Man, yeah, beautiful story, it touches feelings, but he needs an argument. Give me the proof, I want proof. The mind of a man and a woman works different. But not only that. It says like this. If it was true, the claim that women are less than a man according to the Torah, women, right? Do you know, Rav Moshe Feinstein wrote like this. If a woman wants to do a mitzvot of a man, she wants to put tefillin. She says, I want to put tefillin. I'm a woman, I'm not obligated, but I want to put tefillin. Allowed or not allowed?
Allowed.
Huh?
Allowed.
Tefillin? Depend. Listen good. If she wants to do all the mitzvot of the man, if she pure, she has pure body, she came from the mikveh, everything is fine, the body is pure, she wants to put tefillin, she's allowed. She can take her husband tefillin, go to the bedroom and put it, no problem. According to the Ashkenazim, she's even allowed to make a bracha. Haradim don't make a bracha. Women don't make a bracha on a man's mitzvot. The Ashkenazim take lulav, and she make a bracha on netilat lulav. Why? They hold that the bracha is praising Hashem. Praising Hashem, even if I'm not obligated in a mitzvah, just because it's a praise, I'm allowed. But Rav Moshe Feinstein writes like this. He says like this. If a woman wants mitzvot of a man, she can do. But if she wants to keep the mitzvot of the man because she's a feminist, She doesn't like the separation between mitzvot of a man, mitzvot of a woman. What, I'm less than you? You put filin and I'm not? You do this and I'm not? You have mitzvot aseh shehazman grama, mitzvot that depends on time, and I'm dismissed? No. I'm just like you. Whatever a man Hashem told him to do, I'll do the same. Why? Because this is the right thing. A woman like this is a very wicked woman. Putting tefillin every day, she does double than any other religious woman. Double. She does all the mitzvot of a woman, and all the mitzvot of a man, she's 100% wicked. Why? Why? She disagrees with the creator of the world in the way he runs the show. That's called kofer, kfira. Hashem said, this is the right way. Don't tell me what's the right way. I have my own way. This is what we all say. Ani dati baderech sheli. Rabbi, I'm religious in my way. You know how many times I heard it? You're religious in your way. I'm religious in my way. No, no, my friend. There's only one way to be religious, is to follow the book of God. There's no two books. One, you either follow it or you don't. There's no two ways to be. To keep Shabbat is Shabbat 100% everywhere. It's not according to what you understand Shabbat is. It's according to what the Torah says. Then, everything in Judaism is divided to male and female. Not only men and women. Everything in the language, in English, you don't have male and female. You say you, you, it's applied to a man, applied to a woman. If somebody talks on the phone and he say, are you coming? You don't know if he talks to a man or a woman. Right? Because it's the same thing. Because it's a human language. But in Hebrew, in the divine language, if you want to ask a woman if she comes, you say, Atba. If you want to ask a man if he's come, you say, Ataba. So the person who listens to the conversation, they know if you're talking to a man or a woman. Why? Because there's a language for men, language for women. Every word is either male or female. Every word. Every word. How do you know? When I was a kid, my teacher taught me. I said, how do I know which word is male, female? How do I know? He said, you always do like this. You say the word, and then you say after that, yafe or yafa. If it says shulchan, what do you say? Shulchan yafa or shulchan yafe? Shulchan yafe, it's male, shulchan. Kise, kise yafe or kise yafa? Yafe, male. Mapit, napkins. Mapit yafe or mapit yafa? Mapit yafa, female. Napkin is female. Chair is male. Table is male. Shaon is male. What? What does it have to do with male, female? Male and female, we understand. Men, women, everyone has their job. But why the language has male and female? You see, it's much, much deeper than what we thought. Everything in life, it's either male or female. The 6 days of the creation, God say, it's what? Male. The 7th day of the creation, Shabbat, is female. Yom, a day, Yom Rishon, Yom Sheni, Yom Shlishi, what do you say? Yom Yafeh. You don't say Yom Yafa. Yom, all the 6 days of the creation is male. It's the physical work. Sheshet yamim ta'aseh melachtecha. 6 days you do everything you have to do. This physical world is male. Shabbat Amalka, Shabbat the queen, Shabbat is female. The man is equal to the 6 days of the creation, Hashem said. The woman is equal to Shabbat. What Shabbat? 100% spirituality, nothing physical. The nefesh of the isha, nashim yesh lehem bina yetera. They have extra wisdom that the man doesn't have. A man can work 20, 30 years to develop such wisdom. The woman have these skills from the moment she grow up. She has this direct connection to Hashem. It's called nefesh yetera. On the other hand, it says nashim da'atam kala. The secular Jews in the media, they made a parody from this. You see what racist the religious men? Chauvinists. You see? They say women have da'atam kala. What's the difference between bina and da'at? Who knows? When it comes to bina, which is wisdom, they have extra wisdom more than the men. They better in this field. When it comes to da'at, the man is better than them. Da'atam kala. You know what it means, da'at? If you take a woman and send her to be a spy in Iran, and you send a man to be a spy in Iran, and both of them got caught, who's going to tell the secrets faster?
The woman, why? Not because she's not a good soldier. That's her nature. As soon as they tell her, listen, we have your kid. If you're not going to tell us the truth, we'll chop his head off and we burn him and we torture him. She begins to cry. What do you want? Everything you want, I'll give you. Just don't touch my boy. A man is the same, but not as much. He doesn't break physically so easy like a woman. There are certain things in the life of a woman. For instance, woman operates through her feelings, through her heart. Many times you ask your wife what to do, she'll give you the wrong idea. Why? Because she thinks from her heart, not from her head right now. She always used the head. Everyone used the head. But the heart takes a major role. When you tell, for instance, your brother has a son, is not such a good kid. So he asks you, can you take him to America to work in your business? You don't want, but you want to do a favor to your brother. So you say, okay, let him come in. Now you have a candy camera in your business. He doesn't know the boy. So he comes, he works for you. Every day he steals money from the register, from his own uncle. This is his gratitude to his uncle for bringing him, giving him a bed, a room. Instead of kissing his hand, he's stealing money from the register. It sounds strange, but it happens every second in the world. So now you come, you show your wife the camera. Say, I'm throwing him out. What's happened? No, Moshe, don't do it. What's going to be? He has nowhere to go. She begins to cry. If you do it, I'll go with him. What's going on? It's not her fault. This is the way Hashem made her. We're not downgrading her or upgrading her. This is the nature of a woman. The Torah told you the nature of a man and a woman is completely different. Many times a man explains to his wife and he's going crazy why she's not understanding such a simple concept. It's exactly what I say before. You try to put Hebrew in a computer that doesn't have Hebrew, it's never going to work. You ask, what's going on with this computer? Two words in Hebrew you cannot understand? It's not in the system. It's the woman is not programmed like a man. Her spirit, her nefesh was completely different. Things that is obvious to you, she doesn't understand what you want. It looks the most cruel things in her eyes. And the other way around. Things that you do, she goes crazy. How can it be? So let's give some examples of what I'm talking about. It says like this. The word chomer, material, in Hebrew, is already indicating what's controlling material. Every word in Lashon HaKodesh is divine. Remember, it's full of wisdom. The word chomer, how do you write chomer? Chet, vav, mem, resh. It's meruach. If you play with the order of the letters, meruach, come from spirituality. Where material comes from? From spirituality. Every material object, his source is spiritual. Everything. Let me explain. Now you see a piece of wood. You see wool, you see crystal, you see whatever you see. That's 100% raw material. The truth is that there's really no material. It's all illusion. Everything you see in life, see a huge building, the Empire State Building, it looks like a very big thing, no? Wow, such a big monster. In reality, it doesn't exist. The entire Empire State Building, it's less than a little gum. You know, you take a little gum, that's what it is. So why it looks so big? The speed of the atoms that they move in the material is so fast that it creates an illusion in the mind of a person. But really, it doesn't exist. If you take the entire Earth and concentrate everything together, it will be less than a little basketball, the entire world. Why it looks so big? Why it looks thousands of miles of space, of mountain, of so much? I'll give you an example what it is. If you take a fan, it's hot now, you turn the fan. If the fan goes in a slow speed, you see that it has four arms. You see that they're rolling. If you press number two, now it's much harder. If you press number three, now it's so fast that it looks that you have a full circle. But you don't really have a full circle. The circle is not full, it's four arms. But since they move so fast, they create a real round thing that it looks very full. Every material that you see, the speed of the atoms is so fast that it looks like you really have an entire wall
or an entire building, but it's all an illusion in the mind of a person. And everything in material has a soul. Not only a human being has a soul. Material cannot exist 1 second. These atoms cannot move a second without being connected to the spiritual root that Hashem made in this world. If Hashem take away supervision 1 second from the world, and these atoms will stop moving, this entire world will be like Indian bread. Did you ever see an Indian bread? It looks huge. You make a hole in it, all the steam comes out, it falls down, one little bite, finish, nothing, $3. Looks very big, you know? Make a hole in it, like a balloon, all the steam comes out, back, 1, 2, 3, one bite, give me another 5. That's the trick. Everybody knows. In Indian bread, the food is very cheap. How they make the money? From this trick. Indian bread. Next time when you... I hope you never go to there, but next time you stand by the window and you see how they serve the bread, remember, one hole, there's nothing left. This is the way material is. One big illusion. So, Chomer comes from the word me, ruach. Me in Hebrew means from, ruach means spirit, spirituality. En la chomer kiyum, material doesn't have any existence by itself, unless if it comes from spirituality. The difference, the external difference between the body of a man and the body of a woman, the root of it is spiritual difference. That's what people don't understand. They think man looks like this, woman looks like this, because they have two different jobs in life. But the root of the difference, it's a spiritual root. Spiritual, divine root. Since the roots are different, you only see the final product. But to cure a problem, you always have to go to the root of the problem. You cannot cure anything unless if you find the source of the problem. It only look like you cure the problem, the root will create the problem again tomorrow. If you do not touch the root, you don't clean the root, the problem will never go. The root of a man in Shamayim and the root of the woman is completely different. Then, like I said, the 6 days is the female Shabbat, Shabbat Amalka. When Shabbat enter, the woman lights the candles. Why not the men? Why the woman in the house, it's her job to announce Shabbat is coming? Because we are switching gear now. We're going from the 6 day, which is male, into the female territory, which is Shabbat. What could be more natural that the female will accept Shabbat? Because she is Mibchinat Shabbat, she is the female. And when Shabbat leaves and we go back to the 6 day, which is going back into male, who does Avdalah? The man. Why they say woman should not drink from the wine? They made all kinds of stories that if she drinks from the wine, she has a beard. Why is it? It's not true. Relax. If your husband is on a business trip, you can finish the whole bottle, no beard will come. So why they made it up? The one time they told the Chazon Ish, is it true that if a woman drinks from the Avdalah, she's going to have beard? A nightmare of every woman? So the Chazon Ish said, no, it's really a misprinting. Somebody who has beard does Avdalah, not someone who does Avdalah get beard. That was like a... Okay, so the man does Avdalah because we're going now into his territory. So the ceremony, entering Shabbat, female. Shabbat is female. Entering the 6 days, male. That's why Avdalah is a male. Then what? Chayav Adam lechabed et ishto yoter migufo ulehahava kegufo. That's what the Torah really have to say. Not what you hear on television, on secular channels. We have to read from the source. A person has to respect his wife more than he respects himself. They went to the hotel. There's only one nice bed. And a little folding bed, very, very uncomfortable. In the Muslim world, he takes his wife like this. This is where you belong, woman. Don't talk. They destroy them, physically, mentally, beating up. That's what's happening there. I get a lot of emails, Pakistan, this, in Egypt. People tell me what's happening there. In the Torah, it's a very big sin. If a man ever raised his hand on his wife, it's the biggest low life in the entire world, in the eyes of God. To beat up a woman, it's a tragedy, big tragedy. Better you break your head on a wall than never lay your finger ever on a woman, especially a wife. This is the biggest ungratefulness. And this is a common problem in the world today. People lose temper. They cannot control themselves. They push, they do, all kinds of things. So what happened? The Torah says he has to respect her more. You get the nice bed. There's enough to buy one suit. One suit for me for Yom Tov, one suit for you. She comes first. You want to remodel the house. You like this color, she likes this color. Very ugly in your eyes, her color. Don't make a beep. You are the boss. You live here. Most of the time you're here. No problem. Today, our rotten society are doing everything they can, the entire, to destroy the Torah, to destroy the foundation of the Torah. So they created the term feminist, equal rights. Women will go to work, will have career, will be judges, lawyers, doctors, engineers, all kinds of things. Fine, very nice. And who's raising the children? Nobody. That's why almost every other boy today is a criminal in a secular world. Nobody is giving him attention. The boy must get his mother's love and full attention from morning to night every day. The mother wants to be a career woman, no problem. This boy will be messed up for the rest of his life. Make a survey, see. What do you think? The creator of the world didn't know what's good for the woman, what's good for the man, what's good for the children? If he wanted the women to become the career and the men to sew and to change diapers, he will make the world different. But everyone has his job in life. She's in charge of the house. Everything in the house, it's her territory. But if she's 8-9 hours out of the day not in the house, nobody is there to do her job. Unless if you have a very, very devoted babysitter, nice, righteous woman, no, it's better than nothing. But other than that, so the apikorsim, they have all kinds of complaints against the behaving of the Torah towards women. Let's go one by one and clarify all the nonsense that they talk, one by one. First complaint, they say, the Torah says, Nashim da'atam kala. Right next to it, it says, but they have better wisdom than the men. So it's fair, no? The man is better in one field, the woman is better in a different field. So there's no discrimination here? Okay, let's move on. Next thing, it says, the man has mitzvot that subjects to time. Mitzvot aseh shehazman grama. The time creates the mitzvah. And a woman is dismissed from this. So the answer is, besides the fact that she's busy with the kids and she has to give all her time and attention to them, and obviously she cannot go to shul for 2 hours now in the morning when she has to put them and dress them and send them to school, no? So God is reasonable. He knows what you can do, what you cannot do. Cannot do both, cannot be in two different places. So the woman is not subject to schedule in spirituality. She's not subject to any mitzvot of time. But there's another reason. Because the man is the 6 days. 6 days is time, is work. Sheshet yamim ta'aseh melachtecha, asiya, olam asiya. And the woman is Shabbat. Shabbat is the seventh dimension, is above time. Women, the source of a woman in Shamayim, come from a different root. She has nothing to do with time. She is the Shabbat. Why Hashem created Shabbat in a 7 day? Why not 17 day? Why not 50 a day? Why not the third day? Why the 7 day? Because every materialistic thing has 6 dimensions. South, north, west, east, up and down. 7 symbolizing going out of the world of time into a total spiritual eternal world, which is Shabbat. Shabbat is only a taste, a little taste from the spiritual eternal world that God promised the righteous Jews. The woman in the Torah is Shabbat. She has nothing to do with mitzvot that's subject to time. a man that is the 6 days of the creation, his tikkun, is to do what I just said, everything that connects to time.
So it's not only because raising the children and all kinds of things, there's other reasons, there's spiritual reasons for it, not only physical reasons. Then the Torah say that a man in the morning say, Baruch Ata Hashem, Elokeinu Melech HaOlam, Shelo Asani Isha.
Comes there are four women. First, let's explain. Bless you, God, the master of the world, that did not make me a woman. Could it be a bigger insult for a woman? Imagine you stand in front of a Persian guy, Moroccan guy, Yemenite, doesn't matter. Bless you, God, that didn't make me a Yemenite. And your Yemenite friend standing next to you. And he said, you're not embarrassed? And he said to you, what? I have anything to do? I was trying to embarrass you? Nothing to do with you. You won't be able to connect. Your friendship with him is over. If you come in front of another man, bless you that didn't make me this. And this man looks at you and says, shame on you. I'm done with you. So now you come, you stand in the morning, you make Birkot HaShachar in front of your wife. Bless you, God, that didn't make me Miriam, my wife. Or Sarah, my daughter. What's going on here? It's a very big insult. It's insult if a person is an ignorant and fool, yes. But if you know the roots of everything, not only it's not insulting, it's actually just praising God. Let me explain. If you all know, we don't start right away, bless you, God, who didn't make me a woman. What comes before? Bless you, God, who didn't make me a goy. But the Torah say that the Jew must love the goyim. Rabbi Chaim Vital, the founder of Kabbalah, for us. Everything we know from the Ari is from him. Say you must love the goyim, not the idol worshiper. That's a different story. But an average Gentile. Every man and woman was created in the image of God, Jews and non-Jews. A goy that learns Torah is like a Kohen Gadol. Many, many things. So it cannot be that God say, well, the goyim can reach a very high level, and right there we say, bless you that didn't make me a goy. Something doesn't make sense here. And what comes right after? Bless you who didn't make me a woman. And the woman said, bless you who made me as you wished. Shasani kirtzono. But there are three different brachot here. Baruch ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam, Shelo Asani Goy. Next one, Shelo Asani Aved. Next one, Shelo Asani Isha. First Goy, then Aved, servant, then a woman. So it goes from the less important to the most important. Goy has only seven mitzvot to keep. Spiritually, there is a limit how much you can earn from this world. What? It's a person who got a job. Three people got a job in the same company. One comes to work 7 minutes a day. How much he can make? How much he can make in 7 minutes? $7, let's say $1 a minute. $7 they paid him, fine. He has a job, $7. Next one, it's the servant. He comes, 2-3 hours, make $200-$300. Then the next one comes, works full day, make $5,000. So the one who makes $5,000 say, thank you God, who you didn't make me this guy who works only 7 minutes a day. Nothing personal. Why? I would not make any profit. And then he said, but also thank you for not making me the other one who makes $150 a day. So what's going on here? The goy only has 7 laws to keep, and he's not subject, he's not allowed to learn Torah. He can learn general things, but dedicated laws to the Jewish nation is not allowed to learn. Not allowed to learn. Not only doesn't have to, not allowed to learn. Look at the Gemara in Sanhedrin, page 58, 59. Then Eved, what's a Eved? You buy a goy, you come to the market, John Smith is standing over there. Like in the auctions, like today in a car, they used to sell slaves, it used to be an auction. They put him on a big stage, they see big muscular 25 years old goy, and they start bidding. Because the goy is going to become a slave of someone. It was a very common thing. There's Jewish slaves and there's non-Jewish slaves. We are now talking about a goy. Now let's say Abraham comes and he wants to buy a slave. They make an auction, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000, 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 sold. You pay the money, you buy John Smith, he become your servant now. What is the first thing the Torah told you must do? First thing, what is it? No, before, right away you convert him. Not only Brit Milah. You convert him 100%. Without that, yeah, Brit Milah, Mikvah, everything. What does it mean, conversion? He must keep all the mitzvot. There's no conversion without accepting mitzvot. But which mitzvot is keeping? Only like a woman. Mitzvot that are subject to time is exactly like a woman, dismissed. But is higher than an average goy. Goy only keeps 7 mitzvot. A servant keeps more mitzvot than the goy. When he was a goy, only 7 laws. Now he became a servant of a Jew. He converted. He keeps Shabbos. He eats kosher. He makes brachot when he eats. He does a lot of things. Tefillin, he doesn't have to put. Why? It's subject to time, only daytime. Birkat HaLevana we do, doesn't have to. Once a month, specific time. Every mitzvah that is limited to time, like Sukkah, like a woman, exactly like a woman. So now, this is a higher level than a standard goy. And a woman, she's higher level than him. Not only she has all the mitzvot that he has, also, she has some mitzvot that she has that he doesn't have, like all the nida, purity, so she's higher level. So now, this woman is a higher level than him. So we go by the lowest level, spiritual gain. Nothing to do personally, better off be a man or a woman. Nothing to do with what people think. No prejudice, no racism, nothing. No discrimination. It doesn't come from this problem. No. First, who is obligated to learn more Torah? Who is obligated to do more mitzvot? This is what we bless God on. Nothing to do with men and women. So that's not what they say. Bless you, God, who didn't make me a woman. Same thing you said, that you didn't make me a goy and you didn't make me a servant because you made me a man and I'm able to learn a lot of Torah. That's the only reason. Nothing else. Let's move on. It says like this. The daughter is not inheriting her father. Father died, he have 10 kids. 6 boys, 4 girls. He has $1 million. Technically, in the secular world, he writes a will and he gives a tenth to everyone of his children. Everyone gets $100,000. That's what the father left. But according to the Torah, that's not how it is. If the father did not leave any will, and now the children arguing, they go to Beit Din, the rabbis cannot do what they want. They can only do what the Torah say. So they take the $1 million and divide it between the 6 boys. And the 4 women get nothing. How can it be? If this is not discrimination, what is? The answer is absolutely not. Why did Hashem say that only the boys inherit the father and not the girls? Because the girls soon is going to get married, 16, 17, and the old days it was 12, 13. Before you realize, in a year or two, she'll be married, and her husband will take care of her, and one day when his father died, he will inherit his father, and a woman is like the man. She's a partner in everything they own, so she'll get what her father-in-law would leave her. It's no problem. If you're still not convinced, the Torah gave permission to every father to write a will and give anyone he wants whatever he wants. If the father wants to give his girl all the money, he doesn't like his boys, not good kids, and he decides to give in his life everything, he comes to the rabbi, write a will, when I die, take all my money, my houses, give it to my daughters. Perfectly legal. The Torah didn't tell him you're not allowed. We are only talking now when the father died and he did not leave instructions. What does the Beit Din is going to do? Hashem said, in that case, everything goes to the boys. What about the wife? She gets nothing, only the ketubah. When he got married, he asked her, you want to marry me? She say, yes, but depend, how much you going to give me? He say, $3. She said, no, I'm not interested. Okay, 30. Not interested. No, I meant 30,000. You can do better. Okay, 100,000, we have a deal? Sold. She signed, that's it. That's what she gets. She could come and say, you're a wealthy man. You're offering me 100,000? You crazy? I want $5 million minimum. He agreed. He wrote $5 million in a ketubah. One day he died, and he left $10 million. And he has 20 kids. $5 million right away before they share the inheritance, they give it to her first. If he wrote $10 million to her, she gets everything and the kids get nothing. So she's not discriminated. It depends what was the deal between him and her, like everything else in life. You want to give her everything. Sign in a ketubah. You gave her nothing in a ketubah, she left with nothing. It's her problem. Why you agree? So you understand that there's no discrimination here? You want, ask for whatever you want. Otherwise, don't get married. Don't have to marry this man. If he doesn't care about his wife, don't marry him. What happened, you know, in the old days, the women used to do business with their ketubah. Just like when they do with life insurance today. What does it mean? If a person wrote ketubah to his wife, $100,000. And the wife wants to open herself a jewelry store. Hubby, she raised the children already, they're all married. She's bored in the house. She's not the type to retail him. She wants to socialize with people. So she wants to open herself a store to keep herself busy. So she comes to her wealthy husband. She said, open me a business. He said, no, I don't want you in the streets. Stay in the house, retail him. She said, no, I'm not interested. I want the business. Not for me. You don't get a penny. So what did she do? She come to her uncle. Uncle Moishi, yes. I have $100,000 document. You want to buy it from me? What's the risk? What's the risk? When did she materialize the ketubah? Only if she gets divorced or the husband died. If none of it happened, she died before him, she gets nothing. Nothing. He got away with paying the ketubah. Or if she walked on the street not modest, without covering her head, and two witnesses come to the Beit Din, we saw this married woman walk on the street not modest, that second she lost all her rights. So there's a risk, there's a downside to the ketubah. It's not so simple. A woman shelo olechet bedat yehudit, she rebelled against her husband, she refused to have relation with him. I'm not going to the mikveh. Nothing gonna help you. That's it. You'll never touch me ever again. He take her to bed, and they force her to get divorced. There's certain things that you cannot do in a mutual life. But we are not talking about extraordinary cases like this. We're talking the husband died or divorced, she get the money. She died before, there's no money. So she comes to her uncle, she says, buy it for me. So the uncle say to her, hey, I don't understand. What happened if you die, God forbid, before your husband? What am I going to left with? A piece of toilet paper in my hand. I'm not going to be able to collect. She said, of course, you fool. I didn't tell you to pay me $100,000. Give me 50 cash and take the risk, like buying a lottery card. There's a chance, no? My husband is 65. I'm only 45, 50, whatever. Why do you think I'm going to die before him? What's the chance? Look at me. I'm going to the gym every morning. My husband is already 300 pounds. He can hardly walk. Look how he breathes. He smokes. Any day. Don't worry. We retail him, you and I. We'll send him express. You know. Whatever. So the bottom line is, the guy thinking, very good bill. I'll buy it for 50. 5-6 years from now he dies. He's an old man already. I get 100. One guy came to me. He said to me, I have a great deal for you. A few years ago, comes to my house in Muncie. I say, I have an old man. According to the insurance company, he's 73 years old. The truth is, he's 83. They made a mistake when he came to America. There was a war. In those days, they didn't have computers. It was all manual. So they calculate his age wrong, and they wrote 10 years difference. So it's really 83. They think he's 73. So any day, he's going to die. You buy his insurance. It's very high premium. It's like $600 a month, every month. But how much you can lose? Let's say you pay the whole year $7,000, $8,000. Next year, another $8,000. Next year, I think every year it becomes higher and higher. So you put maximum $50,000. But it's a $10 million policy. You'll be the beneficiary. Very good, no? I think this old man is still alive, and all the people who got it, they're already in the next world. So I told him, it's really a good deal. There's only one problem. It's fraud. A Jew is not allowed to cheat. Not allowed to teach the goyim. It's 100% stealing. The goyim allowed this goyim, the insurance company, which by the way owned by stockholders that are Jewish, so you're cheating the Jews as well. But even if it was 100% Saudi Arabia insurance company, LTD, 100% supporters of the Hamas. Are you allowed to cheat them? No. Not allowed to steal. You leave this world with stealing, you have a problem, my friend. Your beard won't help you so much. Probably will make your verdict even more strict.
So, without that trick, it would be a great deal. Yeah, it's a great investment. Almost you cannot go wrong. Let's move on. Man is obligated to get married and have children. Is a woman obligated to get married and have children? The answer is no.
If a woman wants to say, I don't want to get married. I want to sit and learn all my life and read Tehillim and read and sing to Hashem. That's all. Don't want to go on the street. I don't want to do anything. Did she make a sin? No. Cannot do anything to her. The Torah didn't say that she must get married and have children. But a man must do everything he can to get married and have children. The man must.
Nobody asks you if you want or not. You must do it. And at least to have one boy and one girl. That's what the Torah says. So, that's why the man is making kiddushim when you get married.
The feminist asks, why the woman will not put a ring on the finger of the husband? Like the reforms invented now. Why the man, only the man is the boss. Why the man is saying Arat Mekudeshetli? Why he does everything? Why she won't do equally? The answer is, because who is obligated in the mitzvah, he is the one who makes the bracha. If me and a goy is doing something together, he's helping me holding the cow, and I'm slaughtering the cow. Who's going to make the bracha? We're both doing it now. Without him, I cannot do it. Who's going to do the bracha, me or him? If he's going to say the bracha, it's going to be a lie. What do we say in the bracha? Sher kiddishanu, bless you, God, who sanctify us with your mitzvot, and order us to do A, to do B, to do B, to do C. That's it. So if a woman is not obligated, she's not obligated to get married. So how she's going to say, Asher kiddishanu, that you obligate me to get married? It's a lie. That's why the men make kiddushin. No problem. No discrimination. Everyone who is obligated is doing the mitzvah. No, what else? Same thing, divorce. Since the man is obligated to mekadesh et isha, to sanctify her and make her his, that's why he give her something, worth something to buy her. That's when she needs a release. She needs a release. He is the one who can release her because he is the one who got possession on his wife when they did the deal together and he wrote her the ketubah. Today, the feminists and the women rights activists in Israel are fighting very strongly against the fact that women cannot get divorced without their husband's consent. The husband doesn't agree, she's stuck for the rest of her life. I don't want to give you a get. There's nothing you can do. No. Well, I'm not giving you. So they say, what's going on here? We got to change the rules. But we can't change God's rules. There's rules. We cannot do anything with the Torah. It's not in our hand. So tell me, let me ask you a question. Why God made such a rule? Doesn't make sense. Let's think. Why he made a situation that a woman can be now 20 years stuck without getting married? What did he expect from her? That she's going to be lonely for the rest of her life just because she has a cruel husband? And that in the meantime went and married another woman? Because a man is allowed to marry more than one woman. So he got her stuck in New York, moved to Israel, married another young girl, and she is stuck for the rest of her life. So where is the logic here? The answer is, there's no bigger hypocrisy than all these secular women activists in the history for the nonsense and the lies that they spread. They are the one who create the problem, and they come to the religious community to blame them for the rotten rules that they invent. Let me clarify myself. Why today man can make his wife stuck for 20 years without a get? Because the secular court in Israel does not allow the Beit Din to do what God say to do to a man like this. What does the Torah say? If a man doesn't want to give a get to his wife, the police come, take him into the court, take a whip in front of everyone and say, before we start beating you up and killing you here, you're going to sign the get, yes or no? Say, no. Boom! One like this, believe me, you get the point. Oh, you didn't understand yet? Another one, and another one, until it didn't help today. Tomorrow is another day. Let him drink black coffee a little bit. Let him sleep. Tomorrow. How many days she's going to stay aguna? 1 week, if he's really totally crazy, maybe 1 week. But they don't allow to beat up people. It's not we are in the 21st century. You want to beat up people? What is this, Iran here? What is this, Singapore? What is this, Thailand? They whip people? This is not our civilized, it's not humanity. So you come, you tie the hand of the Jewish court because you make secular rules in the country that you're not allowed to do anything to the husband. And now you come and demonstrate in the Knesset, what kind of religion is this? The woman is stuck for 20 years. There's any bigger lie than this? Hashem gave the solution. But they constantly lie to make the religion look not fair. Give the religious court the authority that God gave them, I don't think there will be one aguna. One, you take away his driver's license. You don't allow him to do business. You put a ban on him. You beat him up. You take away all his rights. I want to see one man will leave his wife one day aguna. They don't let. And that's what's happening here. No discrimination whatsoever. The same man who bought you is the only one who can release you. If I own this notebook and you ask me to forgive it, that you can take it, and I say no, I am the only one who can forgive it. Nobody can do it for me. I own it, I will release it. I don't release it, everyone who take it is a thief. The woman belongs to this man. Baal in Hebrew means owner. That's why he bought her. That's why Baal in Hebrew has two meanings. Baal means owner. Baal means the first man who had relation with her. One word, two meanings. That's what husband is. Supposed to be your first man in life. First and last. Unless he died or there was a divorce. But if you live peacefully, one man from the day you became a woman until the day you died, you only knew one man in your life. And that's the best and healthiest way. That's why when he made the woman, he made her with the seal that everybody would know if her husband is the first man in her life or no. But a man doesn't have any sign. Why? Because according to Torah, he's allowed to marry more than one woman. Here comes the next claim. What kind of primitive religion that a man is allowed to marry more than one woman? Is it fair for the other wife? You marry your wife, she's now 40. So you say, you know what, you're not as you used to be when you were 18, when we met. I'm a rich man, let me get a 20 years old girl. Right? All the psychos in Israel, sometimes I want to vomit when I see what these Jews do. Sometimes I'm much to vomit. They have made a big sign in the border between Tel Aviv and Ramat Gan and Bnei Brak. Your wife is too old. Replace her with the Russian, I don't want to say what. Let's say, put a sign on a major road. Replace her. Call this number, we'll find you a new Russian girl. Believe such a thing? Even in America, the source of all materialism and all the nonsense you can think of, they would not dare to do such a thing in Manhattan. Such low lives. And they come to demonstrate against the Torah, these filthy people. Then that's what they do. What do you think they do? Israel is full of prostitution zones in every street, every block, almost every building has at least one apartment. 800,000 Russian goyim came to Israel. Israel is full of pork. Israel is full of prostitution, full of drugs, full of anti-Semites, full of Russian Nazis. That's what's happening right now. 800,000 goyim Mizera Amalek. That's what's happening. Now we're wondering why we have so many problems. why the Arabs are choking more and more and more by the minute. That's one of the reasons. Up to 20 years ago, it was a Jewish state. What Jewish about the state? What? There's a little bit, a million religious Jews, and 6 million not religious, and most of them hate the religion, and the rest is all Arabs and Amalekim and all kinds of Thailandian, Romanians and this, and Polish, Goyim, the Cossacks who drink L'chaim all day and sleeping on the street, drug addicts with needles. Israel is full of it. So why God will make us miracles? Why? It's fair to make miracles?
We gotta be reasonable. We are paying the price.
So the answer is, in Jewish history, it was very, very rare that a man ever marry more than one woman. Very, very rare. And the only reason usually they used to do it, usually, was either that is a businessman who go for months away from Israel with a boat, 6 months is out of the place, is going to sell merchandise or to import, export. Remember, the world wasn't today. You go in first class, 2 hours later you're in the other side of the world. It's a different world. You want to go to India to import silk, you have to go 3 months in the ocean, and then to be there 2-3 months until you gather all the packages, get it on a boat, come back again 3 months. You forgot what's the wife's name by the time you come back to Israel. A man is a man, and he have needs, and in order for him not to make sins, because to make sins is much, much, much worse than have two wives, so the Torah allow a man to have more than one woman. But nobody tells you the truth. You can only have another woman only if your wife approve it. She doesn't approve it, there's nothing you can do. This is what we sign in the ketubah. Take out the ketubah, I'll show it to you. I swear to her, with a handshake, swear. You know what does it mean to swear? There's no better promise than this. Swear to her with kiat kaf that will never ever marry another woman without her permission. And Abraham went with Hagar only when Sarah gave him permission, and all the other ones in history. And still, it was very, very rare. Now, when did it used to take place that according to the Torah, if a man is married to a woman 10 years and they cannot have children? Now, remember, today you have all kinds of tests, laboratories, you can say who the problem is. But up to 50 years ago, you didn't know who is barren, the man or the woman. There's no way to know. So there's no way to know. Maybe I'm the problem, maybe you are the problem. But we are 10 years together, and I must have kids. This is the first mitzvah in Judaism. Now, I love you very much, but I must do this mitzvah. So, in order for me not to divorce you and marry another wife to have kids, because I must, so allow me to marry another woman just for the mitzvah. So what's wrong about it? The Torah says up to 10 years, if it didn't work, he can divorce her. Before that, it's not an excuse. If we come to the Beit Din and say, Rabbis, I want to get divorced. Why? What's the problem with your wife? No problem. Kosher woman, modest woman, Baalat Chesed, great wife, great, everything great. So why you want to get divorced? I can't wait anymore. 6-7 years, I don't have kids. They don't give him permission to get divorced. Come back in 4 years. In 10 years, then we'll talk. You understand? And today, when there are all kinds of treatments, even that doesn't apply. Because today, there's artificial way to become pregnant. So, no racism, no prejudice, no discrimination, nothing so far. What's the next thing? Women are not allowed to be witnesses in Beit Din. Isha psula le'edut. There's any bigger discrimination than this? What's going on? What, the woman is dumb? She cannot say in a court that she saw Reuven murdering Shimon? There has to be a man? What is the logic here? This is a divine law. Why a woman is not allowed to be a witness? The answer is it's not true. Women are allowed to be witnesses. Just depend on what? They are allowed to be witnesses in things that are the most critical in life. For instance, woman is allowed to testify that she went to the mikveh. If she's a liar, you just make isurei karet, the worst in the Torah. Being with your wife without the mikveh is a bigger sin than sleeping with your own mother, in case you didn't know. So when you go now with your wife, and you ask her, did you go to the mikveh? She can lie. She say, yeah. She went to the pool in a Sheraton hotel. She comes back. She pretends she went to the mikveh. She can lie. And it happened in the past. But the Torah says she's loyal. She's loyal to say, I went to the mikveh. A woman makes a meat now. She makes something. And they ask her, where did you get the meat? Let's see, she's a stingy woman. And she went to the Arabs in Gaza. And she bought the meat for $1 a pound. Instead of paying $12 a pound. She said, well, I got it in Bnei Brak. What's the question? The biggest rabbi in the world allowed to eat it based on her testimony. Or if they ask her, did you see your other woman over there, how she make the meat? Where did she get it? She got it from this kosher shop. You listen to her. Did she clean it from the worms, the lettuce? She say, yes, you eat it. So many think she's loyal. So the problem is not loyalty. So why in court she's not allowed to stand on a stand and testify? To reserve and protect her dignity. Look what's happened to the ladies that they had to testify today. The lawyer is ripping her apart, insulting her, humiliating her. Not only her, any witness. Because his job is to save the life of his client. We are talking life and death here. There's no manners. You're fighting for your client's life. So anything that she say may sound like a lie. According to the Torah, the judges, they must investigate in a very aggressive way. And women, as I said before, are very soft heart. They are with feelings, with emotions. It will cause them a permanent damage to their life to stand in front of all the audience and cry and be humiliated. So Hashem said, protect the women's princess, their dignity. Don't humiliate them, a married woman, two children. They ask her intimate questions and everybody hears. That's the reason. Not to put her down. She's the queen of Judaism. That's why don't do anything to them. Don't let them fool you, all these lies. Nothing. The only reason is to protect her and elevate her, not to put her down. What else? If there is a charity fund in town, the rabbi is in charge of it for all the poor people that stand online to collect, to buy food and clothing. And there is men line and women line, and there's not enough for them. Who gets first? You have to give a woman first. Men and a woman, there's enough for one meal. Last meal in a fund. Last meal, $10 to buy, I don't know, whatever you want to buy. Who do you give it to? You give it to a woman. Why? It's no respect for a woman to knock on door and go, give me, I'm hungry, give me food. Protect her dignity, her kavod. Bat Melech, the daughter of the king of universe. You're insulting her, you're sending her. What I said before, when the boys inherit their fathers, when the girls are not married yet, the only way they inherit the father, if they feed the girls with everything the father used to give them. Everything. So which means they live in a house, they eat, they must get them clothing, they must take care of all their needs. And she's a handicap, she needs a special doctor, she needs a special therapist. You must give it to her from the inheritance. All the brothers must supply to the girls. If not, she comes to the Beit Din will put them into serious problem. So she's protected until her husband will marry her, and she's going to be with him, and one day they inherit his father, and she's okay, 100%. So there's no discrimination. What else? A woman is not allowed to marry more than one man. Man is allowed to marry more than one woman. We spoke about it. But why? Men, we understand why, because I just explained. But why a woman cannot come to her husband and say, Itzik, do you mind I have another husband? You be my husband, and he's going to be my husband. Every 2 weeks, I'm going to go to another house. Let's say her husband is a total fool and he agrees. So what's the problem? No, what's the problem? Why Hashem doesn't allow it? Hashem should have said the same thing with a man. You can only marry another woman if your wife permits, if your wife agrees. Why he didn't say a woman can marry more than one man if the husband, the foolish husband of her, agree? No, she got a husband that agree. Fine. So what's the problem? Why it's not allowed?
Who's the father?
For that I need you, Uri. Save the situation. Because you would never know who the father is. Even today when you have DNA, why do you think it's simple to do DNA? First of all, it costs fortune. Second of all, it's not so simple. Because sometimes there's reasons for the father to refuse DNA. You know, he knows it's the other one, but he wants... There's all kinds of calculation. It's better for me to admit that I'm the father. Better not. I want to divorce her. If I admit I'm the father, she's going to want child support. So he said, no. It's not me. He's the father. Let him pay. No. So let's take DNA. First of all, in the time of the Torah, there was no DNA. So it's out of the picture. But even if the Torah was given today, still it would not be permitted. Why? Because a man would say, I don't want to give DNA. What are you going to do? No, here, come. He runs away to Zimbabwe. What are you going to do now? The boy is a Kohen or he's not a Kohen? He's Levi or not? Maybe he's Mamzer. So all kinds of problems here. That's why it's not allowed. You will never know who the father is. Besides that, it's against woman's psychology to be with two men at the same time. And don't give me examples from rotten women today, because society corrupted people so much that people lost total image of God. Ibdu tzelem enosh. Men and women. When in a history a woman went to a club to start with a man that maybe will take her to his house tonight? When in a history something like this ever happened? Except this generation. When in a history a woman went and started to talk to a man bechlal? Even the secular goyim did never dare to do such a thing. Read the history. Only now, oh, guy, cute guy, let me go talk to him. What is this? You understand what's going on here? You understand? That's called Sodom and Gomorrah. It happened. In Sodom and Gomorrah it happened. Sodom and Gomorrah. In Sodom and Gomorrah, women married more than one man, the Torah say. That's why God destroyed them with atomic bomb. You understand? Fire fell from heaven and burned all of them. And just before we finished, I want to tell you, there's one more thing that they complain about, chalitza. If the brother died, your brother-in-law Alenu died, the Torah says marry his wife, have her pregnant, and when the boy is born, call him after your deceased brother. Why? According to Kabbalah, the soul of your brother will return to the world into this baby. So you're doing your brother a favor, or not, you're doing him a huge favor. Now what happens if you don't want to do it? You're egoistic. Your brother didn't leave money. There's nothing to inherit because he inherits his brother's position by marrying his wife. So if your brother didn't leave anything, or for whatever reason you don't like the way his wife looks, all kinds of reasons, you don't want to do this mitzvah. So what happened? You have to go to court and release her to the world, to the market. Release her. How you release her? You take away your shoe, she spit on your shoe, there's a whole ceremony. And she's now dismissed and she can go and get married to another man. But if it wasn't done, she's like a married woman, even though her husband died. Since he died without kids, she can never marry until one of the brothers, doesn't matter who, one would come and do the chalitza. Today, we don't do yevum. No man marry his brother's wife, even if he died without children. Why? Because people are filthy. They are not going with the woman for the pure reasons of doing mitzvah, of bringing a boy to the world. No. Only for physical pleasure. That's pasul. It's not what Hashem wanted. In the old days, people were pure. Today, they're not. That's why it's dismissed. Only chalitza. But you must get chalitza. Every day in the world, people get chalitza. Now, let me ask you a question. The women rights activists and all the other liars out there, they try to pretend and to present that this is the biggest humiliation to a woman, which in reality, it's not even humiliation to the woman, it's to the man. The Torah wanted to embarrass the brother, the egoistic brother, that he doesn't want to have a kid on his brother's name that died. So in front of everyone, she spits on his shoe, and they announce, "Kacha yaseh la'ish, This is what a man who doesn't want to have descendants to his brother, this is what he deserves to get. The entire ceremony is attacking the man. So what does it have to do with her? Nothing. There's nothing to humiliate her. But they know that the people have no idea what's going on in Judaism, so they always draw women in second class. Wrong. It's against the brother, nothing to do with the wife. And one more thing. The woman, she has to dress modestly. That's the law. Why? One reason, because if she's not modest, men cannot control themselves around her. And the chance that the sin will be done is much, much, much higher now when she's provocative. We all know it's true. Cannot argue about that. But that's not the only reason why a woman has to be modest. Even if she was in a world when all men was blind, not one man can see, she still must get dressed 100% modest. Even if she was in an island when there's no man over there, and there will never be, she still must get dressed modest. Why? It's the dignity of the daughter of God. Not only to become a trap to the men around you that cannot control their eyes, no. She still must be modest, even inside the bathroom. The Gemara brings Kimchit. They told her, you have 7 sons. Each one of them became Kohen Gadol in Bet HaMikdash. Something like this never happened in a history and will never happen again in a history. What's your secret? She said, the walls of my house never saw my body once. The walls, not the men. The walls of my house, I was so modest when I was changing clothes under the sheets, the blankets. That's how modest I was. Why? I have respect to my Creator. Not only if it's going to be a sin or not. You understand? I want to tell you a story about one of the most modest women who lived in our time, who just passed away about a month ago. The wife of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, Gdol Ador, Rabbanit Batsheva Kanievsky. Many people don't, you know, I mean, especially in America, not everybody understands what a great person we are talking here about. But for those of you who do not know, her husband is one of the biggest 3 rabbis in the world, according to all opinions, Rav Chaim Kanievsky. Her father is the biggest rabbi in the world, 101 years old, Rav Eliashiv, the top authority in the religious Judaism in the whole world, top authority, even for Sfaradim. Her brother and father-in-law was the biggest tzaddik and the biggest chacham in Israel in the previous generation, the stipler, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky that had Ruach HaKodesh. Everybody testified. He was able to look at you and know exactly all you've seen. People were afraid to go into his office. He used to put the hat on their forehead that he won't see their face. This is the stipler. And her grandfather was the biggest tzaddik before, which was Rav Aryeh Levin, the time when the British were in Israel. So she came from the holiest family perhaps in the world, from all directions. And she herself was a huge righteous woman. Let me tell you a story with her and we'll finish with that. One time there was a woman named Riva, 20 years old girl. She has a boyfriend, a goy. She's about to marry the goy. They tried everything with her. Beg her. She said, I'm sorry. I love this goy. I don't care. I know it's not allowed. Don't try to convince me. It won't help. They took her everywhere. Nothing helped. Then one person had an idea. Let's take her to Rabbanit Kanievsky. She shuts influence with the simple way she is and with her modesty and with her good heart and great manners, maybe she can convince her not to marry the goy. So she sat with her for an hour in her kitchen, and the girl was really influenced by her. But she told her, you know, with all due respect, I'm still going to marry the goy. Don't try to convince me, it won't help. But I'll tell you what I will do. Since I'm so influenced by you, you tell me any mitzvah you want, one mitzvah, and I promise you to keep it every day for the rest of my life. One mitzvah you give me.
No, which mitzvah you give a girl that is about to marry Vini?
Huh?
What mitzvah?
Listen.
Sometimes it's very hard to know, because this could be good, this could be good. There's many options. Very hard to know. But now you need Hashem's spirit on you to answer such a question, because it's life and death, life of eternity. That's when the Siyata Dishmaya come into place. So she told her, read one chapter of Tehillim every day. Sounds very foolish in the beginning, no? This is what she had in her mind? One chapter of Tehillim per day? Maybe she said 20, 30, no? Or to be modest, to wear a dress, to cover the head. Something that will make Vini run away from her. There are many options here. She told her, read one chapter of Tehillim. The girl was very happy. One minute mitzvah a day, he got away easy. So she was about to leave. She told her, wait, let's start the first time together. You and I together. Open the Tehillim everywhere, anywhere you want. Open, randomly. And that chapter that we will open, we will read together. So the girl opened the Tehillim. They are together with their hands, holding the Tehillim together. Opening the Tehillim, chapter 43 came, Mem Gimel. This is the words. It says like this. Hashem, Riva Rivi. What's her name? Riva. It's not a common name in Israel. Very, very rare name. Whose name is Riva? Hashem, Riva Rivi, Migoy. Open chapter 43. Miish Mirma, from a crook. Me'avla tefaleteni, save me from such a horrible sin. I don't have to tell you what happened over there. Both of them were so shocked that they started to cry nonstop. The girl was clever enough to say, I got the point. I got the point. And she didn't marry the goy. This is Siyata Dishmaya. Maybe if we would do it, it wouldn't help. The zchut of this holy woman, when she was a kid, she almost drowned in a bath. Her mother, Rav Eliashiv's wife, Aleha Shalom, went to go to the grocery store. And one woman came, and she said, can you give me a glass of water? I'm so thirsty. One girl or boy. So she said, can you wait 2 minutes? I'm quickly going to the grocery, and I'll come back, I'll give you to drink. She said, I'm so thirsty, I can't wait. Usually, even the most thirsty person will be embarrassed. Okay, I'll wait 2 minutes. She said, I know, I'm really so thirsty, I can't wait. She got upstairs, and what did she find? That her little baby turned the water on and fell into the bath. And that's how she got saved. And this is her. How? Oh, it's a chain reaction. Shem said, and they wrote in her eulogy, that they're sure that the girl or that boy was Eliyahu HaNavi. Who comes out of nowhere? Hey, let me drink. No, I'm going to the grocery. 2 minutes, I'll be back. The grocery is right here. It's not like today. The supermarket is the size of Brooklyn. It's a little tiny grocery across the street. 2 minutes, I'll be back. I remember when I was a kid. The grocery was the size of my bathroom today. That's it. That's how it was. Little refrigerator, gvina melucha, salty cheese in a bucket, few donuts on the counter, breads in the shelves, milk, olives, sliced cheese and sliced cold cuts, 2 machines. That was the grocery. That's it. Few cans, pickles, very tiny. Very tiny. When we had cold cuts, there was a celebration for us. Once a month, I had cold cuts to school on rye bread. Give it to my kids today. Oof. Don't you have something better? What's better? Chinese, pizza, this, that, all this nonsense. Some people came to the world to eat. Some people eat because they want to live. Some people live because they want to eat. And one of the biggest problems that nobody has patience. Nobody has patience for anything today. Nobody has patience. 1 second patience you don't have.
You know what it is? On the highway, there's somebody in front of you and someone behind you. Who do you have patience for? Huh? If the one in front of you has patience, you want to kill him. The one after you, you want him to have patience. I don't mind that you don't have patience. It just depends if you're in front of me or behind me. If you're in front of me, do me a favor. But if you're behind me, have patience. This is what is what's going on today. It's all about me. In Israel, all the candy, Bisli, Kremli, Schnedli, this, Li, everything Li. In the old days, it used to be Krepa Lach, Schneida Lach, everything Lach. Even the name of the food changed. People don't realize, but Mishamayim, Hashem confused us to show who we are. It's all Li, Li, Li. It used to be Lach, Lach, Lach. Mizrat Hashem, thank you for Richie Shasha that organized it, and to all of you that came here to Mill Basin. I was here more than 2 months ago. And sorry, before I went across the street, because it was in a shul across the street, so 15 minutes I was waiting there, and I said to myself, something like this I never had. 15 minutes after the lecture, not one person showed up. I said, Hashem, I'm breaking records. That's really sad. 17 years, and all of a sudden, Mr. Shweki say, where are you? Not in the right place. Thank you very much for coming. We'll hope to see you again.